James Everett Seaver was born October 4, 1918 in Los Angeles, the last of three children of Gertrude and Everett. Along with number one Seaver son Charles and second child Katie, Jimmy was to the manor born at 3143 Wilshire Boulevard, now in the heart of the Los Angeles Commercial District. Jimmy's daily caregiving was delegated to the French nanny, Marguerite Kaufman. There were other French-speaking servants in the neighborhood, and so, through Marguerite, Jimmy met another little neighborhood boy, Robert Stack. Both Bob and Jimmy would attend Carl Curtis, a private school, and L.A. High. Ironically, at the ninth grade graduation ceremony from Carl Curtis, Jimmy was recognized for his acting in the school plays, while Bob won top academic honors. Everett and Gertrude's other L.A. residence was at Santa Monica Beach. There was fun in the sun for everyone. Jim's dad was an outstanding sportsman. Everett passed down his golf gene to Charles, but not to his youngest son. But Jimmy eventually found his sporting métier in tennis. Of course, volleyball and swimming were the things to do down at the beach house. The influenza pandemic occurred in the year Jimmy was born. He got a severe earache that year and had frequent earaches throughout his childhood. This eventually led to considerable hearing loss in one ear. In addition, Jimmy's blood pressure would skyrocket when he went into the doctor's office. Some years later, when he was drafted to fight in World War II, because of both conditions, he failed his physical. Jimmy would improve his tennis game on the court and in the backyard. In his senior year at LA High, he led his team to the California State Championship. At Stanford, he was team captain in his senior year. He and his doubles partner won several big tournaments. Jim would go on to coach the Kansas U team in 1947. Decades of success on the court followed. With 7 decades of experience on his racket, Jim put an exclamation point on his record when in 1997, he and Jay Hines competed in the doubles finals of the Senior Olympics. In 1936, Jim went to Stanford University. His academic interest shifted from geology to history. And in the summers, he lifeguarded at La Jolla Beach. Movie star spotting and side trips to Tijuana relieved the boredom. At Stanford, Jim fell in love with Virginia Stevens. In his senior year, he proposed marriage. Both would graduate with honors and be inducted into Phi Beta Kappa fraternity. Jim was accepted into the PhD program in history at Cornell University and moved back to Ithaca, New York in the summer of 1940. Because Virginia was a year behind him in school, she stayed behind in California to finish her degree. Virginia's parents worked for the Santa Fe Railroad in Topeka, Kansas. The railroad allowed children of workers to ride the rails free until they were 21 years old. Just a few days short of her 21st birthday, Virginia rode the train back to Ithaca and married Jim on December 20th, 1940. Jim had completed half of the PhD program at Cornell when the U.S. entered World War II. After Pearl Harbor, Jim and his new bride moved back to Los Angeles, where they lived with Everett and Gertrude at Palos Verdes Estate. They were near the shipbuilding yards at Long Beach, where both Jim and Virginia worked for Consolidated Steel until 1944. Jim went back to grad school in New York in the fall of 1944. For his doctoral degree at Cornell, Jim wrote a dissertation on the Jews in the latter years of the Roman Empire. He planned to teach Greek and Roman history in higher education. Soon after completing his studies in history at Cornell U, he was hired at Michigan State College in Lansing. He taught several sections of a survey course in Western civilization there. Meanwhile, Virginia gave birth to the first of their three sons, Richard, in 1946. Then Bill, 4 years later, and finally Robert was born in 1952. Limited opportunities for teaching his specialty areas pushed Jim to look for a job elsewhere. He accepted a position much more to his liking at the University of Kansas. He and his growing family would also be just a short distance from Virginia's widowed mother in Topeka. So it was that in the fall of 1947, he began teaching at KU. The first year in Lawrence, the family lived in a seedy two-story army barracks. By the end of the following year, they were living in a tiny cottage nearby. The house on Alabama Street would have been cozy for newlyweds, but with a family of five and Jim's huge collection of 78 and 33 RPM operatic records, it was tighter than a tick. Jim became a big fan of opera in 1931 after he attended a performance of Il Trovatore, and soon afterwards he began collecting records. Jim credits the encouragement of his interest in the fine arts to Normie Hendershot, a beau vivant and lifelong friend. Even in the early 1950s, Jim's collection numbered many thousands. He never missed a chance when traveling around to drop into a Salvation Army store. Jim began sharing his love of opera with a wide audience in 1952 when KU began FM broadcasting. More than 50 years later, Opera Is My Hobby is still airing Friday evenings at 7 p.m. on Kansas Public Radio. The records he had used for so many years to create his radio programs became a public trust in the early 1970s. Jim's donation of more than 20,000 records became the core collection of the KU's Archive of Recorded Sound. Jim began another collection in the early 1950s that would become equally extensive and impressive as his collection of operatic records. Jim first started collecting ancient coins as teaching aids for his history classes. He also used them as visual aids in the Kansas Humanities lectures he gave many times throughout the state. Nowadays, the collection is still growing and has more than 4,500 different types of coins. Jim's academic career flourished. Every year, he taught what he most wanted to teach, ancient Greek and Roman history. And he was the driving force in the institution of a history survey course that became a requirement in the core curriculum of the College of Liberal Arts. The Western Civilization course, modeled on the Stanford course Jim had taken, was instituted at KU. Jim would be the director of the program for more than three decades. By 1960, Jim was tenured and a full professor. By 1965, the Seaver family had moved twice again, first to a house on Main Street on the north side of the KU campus, and then east of Main to an Edwardian brick house on Louisiana Street in the old West Lawrence neighborhood, where they continue to live. The teaching school year ended in late May. The family headed west in August for a vacation. At first, trips were to his dad's dude ranch near Prescott, Arizona, and in later years, to visit his family in Los Angeles. One of three longer hiatuses from teaching first occurred in 1953. Jim took a sabbatical leave and with a Fulbright grant was enabled to live and study for a year in Italy. Under similar circumstances a decade later, the family lived in Israel for a year. The following two summers, 65 and 66, were spent in Costa Rica. Jim and Virginia took a final sabbatical to London in 1976. He retired in 1989, but continued as emeritus professor to teach Greek and Roman history for several years thereafter. Retirement barely slowed Jim down at all. In the 1970s, he helped head up a KU summer studies program in Italy. In the 80s and 90s, Jim and retired KU architecture professor Charlie Kahn led various guided tours to Europe and the Mediterranean area. In the years shortly before his retirement and thereafter, Jim has received significant honors recognizing his achievements. The KU Distinguished Teaching Award, and subsequently the annual Seaver Lecture in the Humanities, the Lawrence Arts Commission Phoenix Award for Contribution to the Arts, the Kansas Humanities Council Lifetime Achievement Award, the James Seaver Scholarship for Studies Abroad, the Fred Ellsworth Medallion for Service to the University of Kansas, and, with Virginia, the Douglas County Senior Center Award for Service to the Community, which is now the annual Seaver Volunteer Leadership Award. On his 90th birthday, Jim's spirit is aptly celebrated with Terence's famous Latin phrase, Carpe Diem.